I want to hear about the solutions, because we all have seen the movie Social Dilemma, right? Like where all these wonderful guys who have basically created the problem saying, oh, it's the government that needs now to sort things out. We're here at Consciously Digital. We are trying to solve things, you know, targeting the digital culture within the companies, within the families. But also there are other solutions, right? Like technological, you're looking also at social impact. Can you talk more about that?
So I'm telling you, so right now the United Nations biggest report is the Human Development Report, and they asked me to write that up for them. So it's kind of like they also like that. So that's kind of like what I started to conceptualize, just to organize my own research agenda. Yes, I get so confused about it. So I did basically this 2x2, right? And it's basically you have either they save us or we save ourselves, and we either change the existing or we create something new, right? So that's basically it. And then you have okay, so if they change, of course, then you know the big ones, the big five, have to change. That is pretty tricky as well, because and they have to. I mean, the 10 richest digital entrepreneurs that exist, and this is of course the Zuckerbergs and the Bezos and the and so forth, they and the Bill Gates, the 10 richest digital entrepreneurs have more cash in their pocket than 40% of the economies have money combined. I'm talking about the entire economy, not what these countries have on their bank account. I'm taking the GDP of the economy. So these 10 white men, interestingly enough, have more cash on their bank account than 40% of sovereign governments. Actually, we could also look at government at economy separately. There are only 20 economies in the world out of the 200. I mean, there are 180 economies, countries that have a GDP. Everything that goes on in this country is less than these 10 white men have on their bank account. Right? They could like spend that tomorrow. And these 180 countries produce that, like doing that. So I mean, yes, we only have the chance to go on our knees and say like, hey guys, we really like somehow we gave them this power, but they have a lot of power, right? And we know, for example, if you just change the orders of the headlines that you see on, and I don't change the content, I'm not introducing fake news, I don't even show you the articles, and I just change the order of the top 10 headlines. I change the opinion of undecided voter for up to 70%. 70%, just changing the order. I'm not manipulating, I'm not like manipulating, like who says, I'm just changing the order like according to my algorithm. So it's a lot of power. I mean, an election you decide by 2-3%, and then we call it a landslide, right? If it's 4%. So 70% is a big power that you have there. And yeah, so they have to change. I mean, we gave them this power out of some strange historical reason, and now we only can ask them to please, because no country is big enough to step up to them. So yes, that's for sure one. Then the other thing is we the people have to regulate, and you know there are a lot of things going on there, and of course you see also Tristan Harris and other colleagues talking about it. They are very smart regulations that we have to adopt, like the fiduciary law. Don't know if you talked about this. So Tristan talks a lot about that. So if do you talk about the fiduciary law as an example?
Not yet.
Okay, good. So I'm, as a professor, I'm not allowed to exploit. I know the weaknesses of my students, but I'm not allowed to sell that to the highest bidder, right? Or your lawyer or your doctor. You tell them your weaknesses. They are not allowed to go out and say like, hey, you know, I discovered the weaknesses. Who wants to pay to exploit it? You know, but social media companies do exactly that. So with the fiduciary law, it's an ethical law that's applied if there's an imbalance in information and you have a power over somebody else that you're not allowed to exploit it. And this fiduciary law is not applied. So there's like, yeah, we have to, and it's not even having new regulations. We just have to apply, or voting propaganda is very regulated on TV, but not in social media. So there's a lot of laws that can be applied there. And then the third is you know, the technological leaders, or the engineers of the future, they have to create new technology. And it's difficult to imagine, but there will be a world after Facebook and Google. Even after Google, imagine. That's what we know from innovation theory. There's no company that survives 100 years. There are, in Germany, where I'm from, it's breweries. So the oldest company on planet Earth are breweries. So they do survive. They do survive 1,000 years, but no other company does, you know. So even the biggest ones. So there will be a world after Google, and what will it be like? And that's the part where, of course, we'll talk about the blockchain. No, I won't. That's if you go to these tech companies, somebody will always say, yeah, but the Bitcoin will solve everything. And it might, and it will. And the blockchain is, I'm really fascinated by it. The blockchain is an amazing piece of technology, and it can completely decentralize the internet. The internet is very centralized nowadays. Google and Facebook are very centralized. And the blockchain is inherently very decentralized. And that's an amazing opportunity to change the name of the game. So I'm a big fan of it. But actually, where I have most of my research is this last one. And that's we humans need to invent a new human. And that's how that's why I'm such a fan of Anastasia's work as well, because we have to evolve ourselves. We have to evolve as a species. And start with the person in the mirror, and see how we can evolve and out-evolve this technology.